I'm Ben.
I'm sorry.
If you would like to get your song reviewed, dear listener, there's the Filthy Capitalist option. It's sorry says 125 gets you straight to the head of the line. You don't have to be a part of the alliance. You don't have to be part of the group.
Wait a minute.
And the biggest thing is you don't have to wait. You hop, skip, and jump right in front of everybody. 125 gets you there. You do that 3 times and then get mashed down to the $75 rate for perpetuity.
Yes!
Also, there is a band review option. So if you've got a band and you're trying to get your band some exposure, hit me up at insoria@gmail.com and I'll show you the details about how to pull
you
that off.
You can also jump on Patreon and there is a option on the tiers to be able to get your band reviewed. Yep. Obviously, we can't lie to you, so we
can't guarantee a positive review.
Get what you get.
It's just rubbish.
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 That's British for garbage.
My favorite is a community option. $1 at the gate gets you in a Patreon. You get to join an alliance. The alliance joins their points together, and that helps determine what songs that we do.
The alliances hang out on Discord.
Shh. Message me on Patreon to get the link.
And they do all kinds of other cool things. They do Minecraft. Dungeons and Dragons.
Yeah, yeah. It's really a community within the community. Anybody can go on the village, facebook.com/VinandSori. There's 160,000+ people on the channel. What's cool about the Discord is that it offers a real opportunity for community connection, friendship, that type of thing.
But, and it's on Discord, so if you're not a Facebook person, it's for you.
You start off at $1.
Right.
Plus you get exclusives. Sori and I are working on a song. So the first 15 seconds of that was on Patreon. Also, at $15 tier and above, when we actually debut the video, they're going to be there live with us. There you are, dear listener.
Bye, merch.
How do you feel about the science
and
now?
And the child shall lead them. There's a little sneak peek of
Middle America.
Check us out, facebook.com/AmericaMiddle. Yes, it's not hype. We truly are Christians, and we are truly about to listen to Naglfar, I think the name of the band is.
I am Vengeance. This one is for our alliance, the True Cult. So they usually give us something dark and sinister. Something great for us to put Christians react to so people can get angry that we put Christians react.
What'd that guy say? Stop doing that.
Nobody cares.
I said, well,
you care, sir.
I said, well, you cared to comment, sir. So it appears to me that at least you care.
Mm-hmm.
Sori, your configurations are crazy
as
hell.
So. I am working on uploading
I don't know how to get any of the files on this device, Sori, because you screwed everything around. Good Lord. Tell the people what you did.
We should, have each our own computers, then we don't have to worry about that. Anyway, so I am uploading stuff to Teespring, so we have a really cool design that actually you guys polled, and I took from your poll that we had on YouTube, and I'm uploading that design now. So there's going to be T-shirts. There's two different prices, so there's a cheaper one that it still should have a really great quality. It should be the same quality as what we had before. And then I added one that was more expensive in case people want a softer, more luxurious feel for their T-shirts. And there's women's cuts and everything. So we are about to do this song.
Yeah. I mean, we're trying to do this song if we can get the file onto the computer. But, here we are.
Here we are.
Good Lord.
Oh, how interesting. What?
Yeah, I got it.
Yeah, it should be right there.
The arrangements
at the top.
Are very strange. All right, Naglfar, here we go. Hey, you want to plug in the audio thing?
Listed.
So headphones can.
man's way because you will get annihilated. Is he supposed to be some god, or is this just like a person?
Well, I have no idea. It's the first time hearing this song, so I have no clue.
Because okay, so
I've got a hot take about this song lyrically. I've got a hot take, but I'll wait for you. Go
these
ahead.
These are the two lines that kind of struck me funny. So crawling in the stench of your own self-deceit is what he was saying to the.
Mm-hmm.
And then at the end, he's like, oh, where did it go? He basically said, anybody who, right there, grinding down all of you who dare to challenge me.
Sounds like Dorian.
Well, yeah, but he sounds like, did he say self-conceit? Oh, self-deceit.
Self-deceit.
Forget it. Strike that from the record.
Oh, you thought he was mad at them because they had conceit.
They were being conceited, and then he was saying...
I have a hot take about this, okay, about what this is it? Thing that you'll have to wait. I'm not going to tell you, and I won't timestamp it either, so okay. Yeah, what can you do? It was funny. On the way home, I was listening to this sociopath. And it was about an hour-long interview with this sociopath.
And when it's stuff like that, you should let me know. I'd like to watch those.
It was a very insightful interview. The kid, I mean, it was basically a kid. He was like 16, 17, but, you know, he's diagnosed sociopath. Although, I forgot the term that he used. It was something, something, antisocial, something, something. But it was just very interesting listening to him talk, and he was talking about how he doesn't feel empathy for people. But the thing is, he was saying he doesn't feel anything, so he doesn't feel happy. Like he remembers growing up and feeling one that he felt different than everybody else, you know. But which, I mean, we're metalheads, obviously, so don't we all? But so he was talking about that, but he was also talking about being annoyed as a kid when other kids his age would get happy or excited.
Oh.
He'd be like, there's no reason to do that. That doesn't enhance anything, blah, blah, blah. Of course, it does enhance it, you know, to be able to celebrate something that's fun. It was a very insightful conversation because most of the time when you think about sociopaths, you just think about the empathy mm-hmm. side of it. Mm-hmm. And this kid was saying he doesn't feel anything. He doesn't get too high, doesn't get too low, and he doesn't understand. So he has to basically synthesize his responses to like that. That's what his so, and it's crazy because his therapist, and I could tell, like, he was just reciting these, I'm sorry that happened to you, would you like me to talk, would you like to talk about it, blah, blah, blah. Like, you know, like, that's what his, he has to understand things logically instead of, he doesn't have the emotional side of it. Mm-hmm. So he's like, your grandfather died. He doesn't feel anything. He was talking about how, like, his grandfather died and how his dad was crying his eyes out. He remembers comforting his dad. And he also remembers knowing that, and they were all close. He also remembers knowing that he was never going to see his grandfather again. And he was like, okay. But his dad was crying, and he didn't feel anything for his dad either, but he just knew this is what you're supposed to do for people when they're, you know, whatever. So with all of his relationships,
that's what he has to do. Now, why does he want to do something for them, though?
Well, he's not like a serial killer. He's trying to find a way to integrate into society. It's just...
Yeah, but if you don't feel, why do you care?
Well,
you don't care and you don't love, then why do anything
else? His whole arithmetic was what's beneficial to him. So there's things he likes doing and things he doesn't like doing. So fitting in with people is more beneficial to him than being him, his total self, because obviously, you know, nobody's going to want to be around him. And so the goals and aims that he has for his life, whether it's education or whatever, he's not going to be able to accomplish if he runs around like a sociopath. There's a reason sociopaths get, you know, excised to the fringe of society. So he doesn't want to be in that situation. So all of his morality, everything about him is about positioning himself to be in the best possible
wow.
situation that's going to benefit him. So it was interesting listening to this song and some of the attitudes in the song, because the interviewer asked him straight up, do you believe that you're better than me? And he said, well, no, I don't believe I'm better than you because you're doing something that's benefit. And the guy had a YouTube channel. He's got like, and it was crazy. It was like 9 million views on that video. Wow. But he said, yeah, the majority of the world, he feels like he's better than, he's like, yeah, I'm better than the majority of the world.
Why?
Because they get tied down by emotions or stuff, something like that. Or they're not, he kept using the word beneficial. There's no benefit to humanity. The vast majority of them are just, you know, these like emotional beings who just go around, you know, whatever. And so he's got all this isolation, you know, these feelings of isolation or whatever, but he's not, it was just a very strange conversation. And he was like, yeah, you know, he talks about how he analyzes a room and knows how to find a mark and know who the most vulnerable, you know, this kind of like Anna was talking about when she went into the store. And it's crazy. He had a heavy, heavy New York accent. And so I was like, you know, it's very hard sometimes to realize who the sociopaths and who the normal people are in that environment. It's very, very hard.
In what environment?
In New York City.
Oh, I was still stuck on Anna's shoes.
Because you can.
Oh, yeah, I can see that.
You have episodes where, and you know, I don't know, but it, like if you just focus on the empathy side of things, like, you know, being in crazy situations and doing like really, really, like, life-changingly violent things to people that cannot be reversed, and engaging in that, and then 10 minutes later, that being completely out of your consciousness and just focusing on,
no way,
oh, we're gonna, whatever, this girl, blah, blah, blah. But you're not like trying to force it out. It's just gone. It's just whatever. So like, that's not, I don't think you can like temporarily be a sociopath. Like, you know how you have like temporary insanity?
Yeah.
And I'm sure like some, you know, sociologists would probably say, well, because you were in such a high violence area and because, you know, violent altercations were almost inevitable and because they always escalate, then it's not uncommon for a person to just shut down the empathy mechanism because they have to do that kind of violence, you know, people at war or whatever, whatever. And I think that that's probably what they would say, but there were people that, It didn't seem to matter whether we were in a high conflict situation or not. They would do things and you could just tell they genuinely did not care. They just didn't care. And, you know, it's some of the stuff you can explain, like I just said, but the other stuff, it's like, I knew a lot of people with this attitude, this sort of like, I am above you, like, you know, and, yeah, I've talked to killers, like, sitting right, you know, like, across from them and been like, you know, this guy had a mom and dad, and you could just tell.
They didn't care.
And it was, one of them said, well, what does that have to do with
it? Are you serious?
Yeah, he was like, well, what's the, he was genuinely trying to figure out, like, I could tell he was confused, like, genuinely trying to figure out, like, what, we had a psychologist in there, and, you know, it's kind of like the Joker character, you know, like, yeah, you know, like that just drives people insane where you just want to choke him, you know, but the whole thing's a game. But I, you know, so it looks like that kind of idea, because it says denounce and curse since my birth because I'm not like thee, because I'm born different, you know, I get denounced. And, you know, obviously I've got the sociopathic kid in my brain, but it's kind of like, the rest of us get put into this horrible situation because it's like, well, if you're angry at the sociopath, it's a mental illness. So are you're mad at a guy for sneezing? Like, how can you be angry at somebody for being who they are. It's not like the kid woke up and said, I'm going to be a sociopath. You know what I'm saying? But the problem is that if a sociopath ends up in your circumference, man, it's a pretty terrible experience, because they truly don't know. They really don't know how you feel. And so they have to operate completely on logic. And, you know, like it's mind-boggling to watch, but you'll see, like, even, and there's, and one of the ways that I know about, like, so-and-so is a sociopath is that there are no exceptions. Like, that's one of the clues to me, to where I'm like, okay, this person is different. So, like, for example, if you bring it back to, like, the violence and saying, you know, why were we able to, you know, box cut somebody and then go on and not think about it again. And it's like, well, you were in a specific area and there are bunches of circumstances where you would never do that. Mm-hmm. But a sociopath, there's like no exceptions. Like, I'm going to be completely heartless to everybody across the board. And the only reason I would display some level of emotion or specificity to a certain type of person is only because I have some ulterior agenda. But like, so for us, like, there were...
That would be creepy to spend a lot of time around somebody like that.
Well, yeah. I mean, I did, you know, and...
Yeah, but that person wasn't completely sociopathic.
No, yeah, to your point, everything's on a scale. Like, this kid wasn't a serial killer. But you could tell that the way that he was talking, that if killing someone benefited him, he would do it. And the other side of it is that he believed, he talked about committing crimes and things like that, not violent crimes, just crimes in general, just so that he could have the rush of getting away with it, so that he could prove to himself that he was smarter than everybody. You know, so, like, yeah, it's on a scale. Like, this guy is kind of like a, you know, petty crime or make your life miserable, but the scale ends all the way at, like, being a serial killer or, mm-hmm. you know, some political... person who, you know,
Ted whatever
drones guy. You know, thousands of people to death, or, you know, destroys, you know, bunches of families, build cages, put like kids in cages and stuff, like that's like extreme level sociopathy. Like, that, we're, this kid wasn't like that. He was a, you know,
yeah, but that
it's a regular type of guy. You know, when he just kind of had his own little agenda, and for the most part, the agenda wasn't being destructive. And the interviewer was like, well, why are you doing this interview? And he was like, well, you know, he just wanted to feel like he was doing something beneficial to validate his own existence. But it wasn't like, you know, I'm doing this to help people or whatever. Because remember, his whole thing was, you know, most human beings are a waste of time and a waste of space because they're not doing anything to benefit anyone.
Something must make him feel excited.
I mean, maybe, but I mean, listening to him talk, I don't know.
Was his voice bland?
I mean,
did he have voice fluctuations?
I mean, it was pretty steady. I mean, the way he was talking about, like, he was talking about the death of his grandfather and the weeping of his dad in the same way that he talked about, you know, getting a sandwich. Like, the same inflection, same affect, everything. Like, the guy, like, there were literally no exceptions. And people like that are extremely dangerous because, you know, obviously, if you don't have much feeling and you don't view other people as being equal to you, then when you combine that, now you see why they're... It just made me understand, like, oh, okay, this is why we have serial killers. Because when he was talking about, like, breaking the law and how it actually made him feel superior and validated his, you know, initial theory, it's like, yeah, when you combine all those with extremes, then you get, you know, you end up with a Ted Bundy or all the rest of it. Like, you end up with people who, you know... They just ask those questions to themselves and they say, yeah, why not cross that line? Why not do that? Why not go there? And like, that's crazy.
You know, I think it'd be really sad if your child turned out like that, you know?
Oh, yeah.
Like.
Oh, yeah. No, I know. I know it would be extremely sad. And the other thing is like the, you know, the world doesn't understand or won't care to understand. Like, nobody cares, like Ted Bundy, all the rest of these people. Nobody cares about them, what they've been through, you know, being abused. Like, we were watching that movie with the active shooter. You know, it was these kids. It was one of these Ben Shapiro movies, active shooter. And it's this girl that's the heroine or whatever. But and then, you know, they made this girl like the voice box of pretty much America when, you know, because she was talking to one of the kids that was doing the active shooter. You know, the stereotypical kid, the outsider. I got made fun of a lot, blah, blah, blah. And so the kid finally was able to do a monologue, and he looks in the camera and he talks about all the bullshit he's been through and the pain he's been through. And then this girl responds back in typical fashion for people of that ilk. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if your mom didn't give you a lolly when you were five. You know, just like completely dismissive and, oh, the only reason somebody would do that is because their mom didn't give them a lolly when they're five. It's just a bunch of spoiled kids. No. There have been spoiled children for millennia. Like, something is seriously, seriously wrong with these people. And they're in a hell of a lot of pain. And they have mental health issues. But because of our, you know, we have a for-profit healthcare system, they're not able to get the mental health care they need. And it's to the point where it's not even recognized. Like, you know, like... You know what I'm saying? Like,
And then
when the kid gets extremely symptomatic and starts blowing people away and blowing his friends away and blowing himself away, we get to say, oh, we don't care. You know, your mom didn't give you a lolly when you were five. Just completely simplify it and completely dismiss the pain of these people. Well, I mean, okay, fine. That's cool. Like, it makes us feel morally and sociologically superior. Great. But we're not solving any problems.
Yeah.
And to this moment, like, I will never forget. Go watch it. The Joe Rogan, it was in 2019, I'm pretty sure it was. Joe Rogan and Bernie Sanders were talking. And Joe is a gun guy. He likes hunting and all that stuff. And plus, you know, he's combat sports guys are generally going to be, you know, they're going to be gun people. So obviously he's not a fan of Bernie. And it's really funny too, because Killer Mike was like, yo, chill, bro. Chill on my guns, Bernie. And Bernie's like, we're just going to have to compromise on that. And he's like, all right, whatever. But like, Bernie was talking to Joe Rogan, and he was talking about guns, and they were talking about the gun crisis and the active shooter crisis, and then the very next subject was healthcare, and but they were not connected, and I truly, truly believe, like, we're talking about guns and stuff like that, like, if you look at the lyrics of this song, I was singing about those kids from Columbine, and they were saying that same type of thing, that people were beneath them, they were below them, they were the next stage in evolution, yada, yada, yada. You know, it's this sort of mentality. And I don't know if it's like, okay, do these people really believe this? Or, I'm not particularly clear. And perhaps a person might say, what does it matter? Who cares? Like, they're running around shooting people. Like, let's get rid of them. But the burning point was really interesting. It's like, look, we got these people in this situation. And they have all these mental health issues, but they can't get help for anxiety and, God forbid, schizophrenia and you know, schizoaffect. You know, like, all these issues, and then you combine the mental illness factor, and then on top of that, you combine the lack of care and lack of treatment factor, and then the last angle of the triangle would be the ubiquity of firearms in this country.
It's just,
and you put those three together, and that's why our European friends don't understand what's happening. Because our European friends, they have mentally ill people in Europe just like we do. The problem is the second point to that triangle is, but they have universal health care, and they don't have universal gun care. So when you put, so it's like they don't understand when they're, I can tell when we're having the conversation, trying to explain to them, they don't get it. They're like, what is going on here? That's what's going on. So this song, like, actually, I know it's meant to be blasphemous and all this stuff, but in reality, I literally, like, right as I came in, I got done listening to the interview and then I saw that. And so it's like, yeah, I mean, it's easy to look at that guy as a villain and he's projecting being a villain, some sort of demon lord. Mm-hmm. But deep down, it sounds like this guy is trying to... he's trying to metalize his pain and suffering is what it looks like to me. And he feels really upset about being left out of society. So there you go.
So what was the part you were going to say later?
Oh, my hot take?
Yeah.
My hot take was... Okay, so in Street Fighter... The most noble.
You were gonna miss your hot take.
I was, because the most noble person in Street Fighter is Ryu.
Okay.
And he's noble because his sole motivation is the fight.
Okay.
So like Guile, his motivation is vengeance because Bison killed Charlie, his best friend. Chun Li, her motivation is vengeance because Bison killed her dad. You know, so like, but Vega, he's corrupt because his motivation is his beauty. But, you know, Sagat is fighting because Ryu beat him up and he's got this big scar on his chest. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Ryu was just some little kid, the 16-year-old mm-hmm. that did it to him. But Ryu is fighting for the fight itself.
Okay.
And so he's the most noble character in the Street Fighter universe. Well, they came up with this character called Evil Ryu.
Okay.
And of course, they made him dark. You know, they darkened everything. They darkened his complexion, blah, blah, blah. And they gave him red eyes. So he's Evil Ryu. And he is what you think he is. It's like, oh my God, this most powerful, most noble person now is Evil Ryu. Holy shit. Well, what if you had Evil Jesus, right? And this song is written from the perspective of Evil Jesus. So you go back to the lyrics and think of it again. I shall cleanse the earth of the worm. Look, humanity, what have you ever done for me?
Wow.
Denounced and cursed since my birth.
Wow.
For I am not like thee, using, you know, Elizabethan yeah. English, which kind of harkens back to a religious context. A proud descendant of the ancient seed, he would be proud considering he's a descendant of God, driven forth by the screams of my enemies. I am the plague that shall grace you with an early grave. Exterminate, bring. So this is Jesus going,
that's,
you know what?
Crazy, yeah.
Because Isaiah, I think it's 43, where he says, I have spent my strength in vain. And then God has to show up and say, chill out, Jesus. You haven't spent your strength in vain. It's okay. You're going to be okay. And you're going to accomplish a lot more than you think you are. God has to kind of comfort Jesus and calm him down. But imagine if Jesus says, I spent my strength in vain, screw these people. And and then boom, boom, boom. You know, so.
But wait, lack of faith is not sin?
Well, no, because he did spend his strength in vain with the majority of Israel. Because remember, the majority of Israel was going to be hardened. So that wasn't like discouragement. That was him facing the reality of the fact that his own kinsmen were not going to embrace him. So that's a legitimate concern of his. So, but imagine like if God didn't show up and comfort him and he just completely went corrupt and he was like, you know what?
Oh my gosh.
Screw all you guys.
Oh, that'd be so bad.
I mean, I would. That's what I would have done.
What do you give the song?
The song, the name of the record is Sheol, by the way, which means grave in... the Hebrew Bible. Sometimes it's incorrectly translated as hell in the KJV. I give this song a solid 9.
Oh, wow.
Solid. Parents, if your kids, especially Christian parents, if your kids are listening to music like this with lyrics like this, don't freak out. Talk to them.
Find the angle.
Right? Just like, especially if they're playing it to where you can hear.
Yeah, find out why they like it.
That means they want you to ask questions. Trust me. They're not gonna tell you like straight like that, but trust me, that's what's going on. They want you to ask questions. Ask questions and tell them, look, no judgments. I just want to know what the hell you're doing.
Follow through with that and don't judge.
And don't, right. And if you do judge them, just judge them quietly.
Yeah.
A good strategy.
8.2.
There you are, dear listener. Good song. Moral of the story is don't be a sociopath. If you are, please let us know. Vin out.
Sorry out.
Gone.